You know, one of the reasons I really wanted to write this book was to re-examine the important issues that have surfaced over the course of my career. Our changing notions of gender identity, the evolution of gay rights, our understanding of systemic racism. We've all been working to acknowledge and embrace these societal shifts. In many ways, the music industry is undergoing its own reckoning as it strives to be more inclusive and represent a wider array of voices. And my next guest is one person who is changing the face of music in Nashville. Her name is Allison Russell. Allison is one of those multi-hyphenate talents. She is a Scottish, Grenadian, Canadian, multi-instrumentalist, songwriter, and poet who, after years of collaborating in bands like Poe Girl, Birds of Chicago, and Our Native Daughters, has just released her debut solo album. It's called Outside Child, and I can't wait for you all to meet her and hear from her. Please welcome Nashville's own Allison Russell. I am so excited to be able to share Allison's story with you because she's got a remarkable story. And congratulations on your first album.
Thank you.
Which is so exciting. And I know it's a deeply personal album about your childhood, which was a very harrowing one. And this was a way for you to kind of tell your story through music. So can you tell everyone a little bit about your backstory, Allison?
Yes, I can. So I am, as Katie said, Scottish, Grenadian, Canadian, born and raised in Montreal, Quebec, Canada. My mom was a baby when she had me. She was 17 when she got pregnant, 18 when she had me, and her family were not supportive at that time. In those days in Quebec, I was born in 1979, to have a child out of wedlock and to be a white mother having a black child, there was a lot of stigma around that. So we had a rough start, and I was removed from her care under Child Protective Services when I was under 2 years old and spent several years in foster care. And during that time, unfortunately, my mother was sort of preyed upon, groomed, and married by a very abusive man who then got me back from Child Protective Services, became my stepfather and then my adoptive father, and was very severely abusive, sexually, physically, and psychologically for a decade. And I ran from that situation when I was 15 years old and lived unhoused for a time.
And I know you were like sleeping in cemeteries you were homeless, basically.
I was, I still went to high school. I went to this wonderful alternative high school in Montreal called Mind, Moving in New Directions. And there was a student lounge, so I would go in there early in the morning and sleep before class. And I didn't tell anyone what was happening because I wasn't ready to disclose to people yet. I mean, I think that's one of the things that folks who have not gone through severe abuse, who aren't direct survivors of it, don't always understand that. You hear comments like, well, why didn't they say something years ago? Or why didn't they call the police? Or they don't really understand the kind of indoctrination and crushing of a spirit and a mind that happens, and a colonizing of a mind and a spirit and a body that happens. And it takes time to deprogram, you know, it takes time.
I interviewed Tarana Burke in LA.
She's
amazing,
incredible.
And I would love to connect the two of you.
Because I have wanted to meet her forever.
Well, I'm going to make that happen. So tell me about how you discovered music, because it was music, really, Allison, that saved you. So how did that happen?
Yeah. You know, it's Montreal. Montreal is a city like New Orleans, just steeped in music. It's a melting pot city. It's a port city. It was the northernmost point on the Chitlin circuit, the old blues R&B circuit. You know, B.B. King would come up and play. I grew up at the Montreal Jazz Fest where we had free concerts. I got to hear Oscar Peterson in the park and Umu Sangare and just incredible artists. I was surrounded by music growing up. And my grandmother, my maternal grandmother, Dr. Isabel Roger Robertson, taught at the University of McGill, and there's a beautiful music conservatory there. And I would go and listen to the students practicing, and music was all around me all the time. And I think when I left home at 15, I started a kind of a duo with my friend White Allison. We called ourselves Sister Blackfish, and we would write these silly songs. We were obsessed with Kids in the Hall, so we would try and do sketch comedy. We were awful, but we would go and busk in Old Montreal, and tourists would take pity on us sometimes and give us money. Loonies and Toonies, which are $1 and $2 coins in Canada. And I, you know, that was the, when I, that's where it started. We started writing these comedic songs together, but then I just got deeper and deeper into writing poetry, writing songs.
And you're totally self-taught.
Yeah.
And so what brought you to Nashville?
Community, really. Like, we moved here not so much for music industry, kind of capital M, capital I, but because we had so many dear friends here in town at the time. Rhiannon Giddens was on the Nashville TV show. She's a chosen sister of mine. Abigail Washburn is a dear friend, and our kids were in the same early childhood program here together, and Luther Dickinson and his wife, Nisha Dickinson. So we just had this community of friends that were here who were also artists, who were also raising their families while continuing to follow their dream and their passion. So it just felt, we honestly, our daughter was 3 when we moved here, and we thought, well, she's gonna need to go to school soon, and it's better to be in a place where schools understand about musician families and touring families, and schools in Nashville understand about that. So that was a big part of the impetus for us to move here.
And you don't identify, Allison, as a country artist, really. I mean, how would you describe your music?
Yeah, I mean, I guess I'm more within the Americana community. That's the community that's kind of welcomed me in. Brandi Carlile, who is our queen of the Americana community, has been such an amazing friend and advocate, and is a big part of the reason why my record got signed. She called up Margie Chesky, the head of my label, and just said, please listen to this. And that was how the conversation started. So I've just been embraced by that community. It feels more expansive, I guess. And I shouldn't say that I'm not as familiar with the country music industry. I'm more adjacent to it. And I think as an artist, I'm quite genre resistant, because genre is so mired in our constructs, false constructs of racism and bigotry and misogyny. And it's something that kind of dogs our music industry still to this day. We're still trying to decolonize and unpack and have greater equality and representation kind of across the board. But certainly the country music industry has been struggling with that in the last few years, you know. But I see a lot of great momentum and change, and I would say I'm country adjacent and very, very much appreciative of and influenced by a great deal of country music. And I, you know, people like Reese Palmer and Frankie Stanton, that kind of Reese took the torch from, Dr. Cleve Francis, and there's so many incredible artists in Nashville right now who are really just kicking the door down. And it's such a beautiful thing, because nobody loses, right? When we're let in, nobody loses. It just enriches everything.
Yeah. I agree. That's you know, at this isn't Allison so beautiful and eloquent? And I'm so happy to have you here. But you know, we saw this incredibly moving performance at the CMAs, which to me, that's okay. I do that too. Ushered in, you know, seems to usher in at least the potential, the possibility for change. And that was with Mickey Guyton, Brittany Spencer, and Madeline Edwards.
Yeah,
and they were singing a song, I Love My Hair.
Yeah.
And I think we have a clip of it, Nate. Let's listen. That's something you wouldn't have seen at the CMAs even a few years ago. Watching that performance, Allison, what did you think?
It was thrilling. You know, I'm just such a huge fan of all three of those women. And Brittany Spencer is a dear friend. She and Brandi Carlile sang a song of mine, Night Flyer, with me on Jimmy Kimmel Live, my first ever TV spot. They did it with me during the pandemic. And I love them, and to see them just shining and opening people's eyes and minds. And I just think about little black girls singing at home going, I can do that too. You know, that's this is for me too.
You can't see it, you can't be it.
It's for everybody, exactly, exactly.
I'm a big proponent, and I write a lot about this in my book, about confronting the past and sort of acknowledging the past as a way to pave a better future for everyone, because you have to be honest about what transpired in order to move forward. I'm a big fan of Bryan Stevenson, who talks about truth and reconciliation so much. And I know the song you're about to play for us really embraces that theme. So can you tell us about it?
Yes, I can. So this song is called Quasheba, Quasheba. And Quasheba is my many times great matriarch of my paternal lineage. So she was a woman who was born free somewhere, we think in the west coast of Africa. We don't know, of course, because that's been lost to the process of colonization and enslavement. But she was kidnapped. She was sold off the coast of Ghana. She survived the Middle Passage. She survived multiple enslavers, at least one plantation in Trinidad, and wound up dying on a plantation in Grenada. And learning her name when I met my biological paternal family when I was 30 years old, it was a really transformative, pivotal moment in my life. And learning about the history, the black diaspora history that I'm part of, and understanding that my story and what happened to me was not in a vacuum, that it was part of a whole long lineage of intergenerational trauma and violence. But also the other side of that coin is intergenerational strength and hope and resilience. And we can't forget about that part. When we try to erase all the bad stuff, then we lose our strength and we lose our roots. So we need to remember it all and bring it all forward. And I wept when I learned her name, and I feel so much gratitude that she survived and that she somehow kept hope alive in unspeakable circumstances, because I get to be here now and my daughter gets to be here, and we have more agency than any woman of our lineage has ever had. So I'm really grateful. Yeah. Yeah.
So you're going to perform it for us? Okay, no, that's so exciting. I can see why you're a poet. I mean, everything you say is so beautiful. So Allison's going to perform for us.
I just want to say thank you to you, Katie, for having me here, and congratulations on a beautiful book.
Oh, thank you.
No matter what your lineage, your geographic place of origin, we are one human family, and we all come from long lines of survivors, and every single one of them lived through times harder than these. So this is for Quasheba.
Shoot! we have life. You dreamt of home, you dreamt of freedom. You died a slave, you died alone.
Thank you.